Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Mysterious Case of Rudolf Diesel, Genius, Power, and Deception on the Eve of World War I by Douglas Brunt. Read by Scott Brick. For Jackie and Manly. Author's note. This book began in 2015, when I bought an old boat. It was a 38-foot runabout built in 1996 with the original gasoline engines. I stood on the dock by my new purchase and spoke with the gentleman who owned the boatyard. He'd run the yard for decades, having taken it over from his father, and the whole place appeared frozen in the 1950s. The man's face was rough and tanned from the sun and salt air, his fingers like stones. He rolled his own cigarettes. I asked him what he thought I should do to fix up the boat. He said that a boat like this should have diesel engines, not gasoline. I had always thought one engine delivered on the same promise as any other, so I asked him why. He launched into his reasons, that on my 200-gallon fuel tank I'd get twice the range, that I wouldn't breathe noxious fumes from the diesel fuel the way I would with gasoline, that nearly all boat fires came from gasoline engines, and none from diesel. He held up the stub of his cigarette, which looked like a splinter pinched between his fingers, and said, "I could drop this lit cigarette into a barrel of diesel fuel and nothing would happen. Gasoline engines start with an electric spark, but not diesel. Diesel fuel's not flammable, and the engine doesn't use a spark. The fuel needs to be pressurized inside the engine first. Diesel is a different engine, a better one." I followed the old salt's advice and repowered the boat with diesels. A year later, in the strange lull between having finished one novel and not having started my next, I was doing what I always do to connect with a new idea. I was on my computer, exploring anything and everything, plucking the threads of random discovery that bring me to different eras and geographies. As I clicked my way down threads, sometimes following one for a great distance, then hopping to a new thread, I came upon a list of mysterious disappearances at sea. Down the list a bit, I saw the name Rudolf Diesel, and wondered if there was any connection between this person and my new diesel marine engines. I clicked to a summary of the events of September 29th, 1913, and began the extraordinary voyage that led to this book. Prologue. October 11th, 1913. There was something in the water. Crew members of the Dutch pilot steamer Kurtzen approached the object that had caught their attention. There, near the mouth of the Scheldt River along the eastern edge of the English Channel, in the rippling black, the men on the small vessel realized what they'd seen. It was a body. Though the decomposition was ghastly, the sailors noticed the fine quality of the clothing that still wrapped the body. Pulling the remains alongside the boat, they plucked four items from the pockets of the deceased before releasing the rotting corpse back into the waves: a coin purse, a penknife, an eyeglass case, and an enameled pillbox. The steamer then made its scheduled call to the Dutch port city of Vlissingen, where the crew reported the discovery and turned over the items. Harbor officials immediately wondered if the report from the Kurtzen could be connected to the missing person case that had been in the headlines of newspapers in every major city in Europe and America. Officials sent word to the missing man's son, who arrived in Vlissingen from Germany the next day. As soon as he saw the items, Eugen Diesel confirmed that they belonged to his father, Rudolf. Rudolf Diesel, the inventor of the revolutionary engine that bears his name, had disappeared almost 2 weeks earlier during an overnight crossing of the English Channel on his way from Belgium to London. The captain of the passenger ferry had reported Herr Diesel missing at sea, in international waters where there was no legal jurisdiction and no investigatory authority. Since there was no body, there had been no coroner's report. There was no trial by admiralty, nor even a company hearing. There had been no official investigation at all. No ray of light on Diesel mystery. German inventor was a millionaire and his home was happy. From the front page of the New York Times, October 2, 1913. Rudolf Diesel grew up during an industrial boom. In America, it became known as the Gilded Age. In France, it was called the Belle Époque. Economies flourished and urban centers developed at unprecedented rates. Through his childhood, Diesel witnessed this expansion from the vantage of an impoverished immigrant. His nomadic family scratched out a living in cities across Europe, until a relative recognized the boy's gifted mind and offered him a hand up. At the age of 12, Diesel took the modest opportunity for an education and made the most of it. With natural ability and the determination of the most desperate, he excelled at his studies, and by his early 20s he inhabited the most revered circle of engineers in Germany. His scientific peers were Edison, Tesla, Bell, Marconi, Ford, Einstein, the Wright brothers, names that would achieve cultural immortality. These geniuses delivered innumerable advances in science, spawned new industries, and destroyed existing ones, have been the subject of books, films, and other tributes, and have been the shoulders upon which countless others have stood. Yet, Rudolf Diesel is missing from this list. Throughout history, the world has often adopted technological advances in ways the inventor never imagined, and certainly never intended. The advances wrought by Diesel and his contemporaries changed their world from a place of decentralized rural economies to a place of mass industry, from the age of steam power to the age of oil, from battles fought at close range between men bludgeoning each other to mechanized warfare. As empires, both political and corporate, applied revolutionary technologies to accelerate their advance, the unintended consequences of an inventor's brainchild could wreak havoc and terror. In the time before Diesel's engine became ubiquitous, the great battleships such as the British Dreadnought and the great passenger ships like the Lusitania and Titanic were equipped with steam engines. The steam technology pioneered by James Watt was as old as America and was the genesis of the Industrial Revolution. Shipbuilders installed a giant boiler filled with water, a coal-burning furnace stoked by teams of men to turn the water to steam. The steam pressure turned the gears of the engine, and finally, a chimney and funnel that released black towers of smog from the coal furnace. It was rudimentary technology. A ship raising steam from the cool water in the boiler of an idle engine took hours to get underway, and the tons of coal needed to feed the furnace took up valuable cargo space. The dozens of men living on the ship to shovel the coal took up more space and needed to be fed as well. The massive and inefficient engines required the ships to hop from port to port around the globe to acquire more coal, announcing their advance with a smoke-stained sky visible for 100 miles. The Diesel engine didn't require hours to boil water. It operated immediately from a cold start. Nor did it require teams of men to stoke the fires, but simply drew liquid fuel automatically from a tank. The compact engine had no boiler, no furnace, nor chimney apparatus at all. Diesel burned a viscous fuel that had no fumes, was safe to store, and the engine consumed its fuel so efficiently that a ship could circumnavigate the globe without stopping to refuel. And it did so with no discernible exhaust to give away the ship's presence on the horizon. What's more, the fuel for a diesel engine came from the natural resources that were abundant nearly everywhere. Diesel's design was a quantum leap forward in humankind's ability to convert a substance into power. His engine became the most disruptive technology in history. Diesel intended for his compact, safe, and efficient engine to lift up rural and urban economies alike, to do the work previously done by the backs of men, to advance the quality of life for all. But his intention was not to be. When Rudolf Diesel went missing in 1913, the major newspapers from New York to Moscow ran front-page stories about the great scientist's disappearance. Though suicide by drowning was the working theory, the press also advanced the theory of foul play and named two of the most famous men on the planet as the prime suspects. One theory pointed to the German Emperor, Kaiser Wilhelm II, and his agents, hypothesizing that the Kaiser was so enraged by Diesel's rumored business dealings with the British that he had ordered the inventor's murder. One headline read, "Inventor thrown into the sea to stop sale of patents to the British government." The other high-profile person, who some suggested could be behind Diesel's death, was the world's richest man, John D. Rockefeller. Rockefeller and his cohorts viewed Diesel's revolutionary technology, an engine that didn't require gasoline or any product derived from crude oil, to be an existential threat to their business empires. Another headline claimed that Rudolf Diesel was murdered by agents from big oil trusts. In death, Rudolf Diesel, the genius inventor, was at the center of a great mystery. Only 1 year earlier, in 1912, major figures on the world stage had lauded the emergence of Diesel's game-changing technology. Thomas Edison pronounced the diesel engine one of the great achievements of mankind. Winston Churchill, an early admirer and advocate of diesel motors, declared a new class of diesel-powered cargo ship to be the most perfect maritime masterpiece of the century. Now, Rudolf Diesel, the man whom the famed British journalist W.T. Stead described in 1912 as the great magician of the world, was gone. In an industrial age, nothing moves without a motor. It is the beating heart of nations, and no inventor was more disruptive to the established order than Rudolf Diesel. The terrible irony is that Rudolf Diesel abhorred the societal evolutions that his engine wrought. He opposed economic centralization to urban centers.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.